And then I'll just turn it to Seeley since it's their event.
Thank you, Dr. Misi. Wow, that's great. I guess we'll have more volunteers to help plan this next year given the fact that there's gifts involved, so thank you. I got to start by saying thanks to the people that helped plan this. Besides us, there's a student committee that planned this, which is true, but the Barshop was very, very helpful, both monetarily and physically. There's the faculty and staff, and they knew who they are, and this wouldn't have been orchestrated correctly without their help. So many thanks to you guys, and we couldn't have done it without you, so thanks. So we're very excited to host our distinguished guest this afternoon, Dr. Martin Chalfie, so I'll tell you a little bit about him, mostly from Wikipedia, but I bet it's correct. He was born in Chicago, Illinois, and attended Harvard University for his undergraduate studies. He went on to earn his PhD in neuroscience at Harvard under Dr. Robert Perlman, followed by a postdoc position at the highly esteemed Laboratory of Molecular Biology in Cambridge, England. There, he worked with really titans in the field of molecular biology, Drs. Sidney Brenner and John Sulston, before returning stateside to Columbia University in New York, where he still operates a very active research laboratory. Dr. Chalfie has many honors bestowed upon him, obviously, including the E.B. Wilson Award, or Medal, election to the National Academy of Sciences, and most importantly, probably, maybe, the Harold S. Ulin Leadership Award as captain of the Harvard swim team his senior year, I'm sure he's quite proud of. In addition, he was also awarded the 2008 Nobel Prize in Chemistry along with Drs. Osama Shimamura and Roger Shin for the discovery and development of the green fluorescent protein, otherwise known as GFP. In his seminal 1994 paper, which is actually out in the front if you want to see it, it's a pretty short article in Science, and it was like made the cover of Science as well, he elegantly demonstrated the use of GFP, which was purified and cloned from a jellyfish, to monitor gene expression in two model systems, eukaryotes and prokaryotes. This contribution significantly altered the landscape of molecular biology, and GFP has truly become a fundamental tool in the repertoire of the modern scientist. So it's quite an honor to have him here. His work brilliantly illustrated how basic science research can be applied to solve complex biological problems that have human implications. And in this same principle, an equal merging of basic science principles and applied science principles is really an important research mission here at University of Texas Health Science Center and at the Barshop. So we couldn't be more honored to have him here. So without further ado, Dr. Martin Chalfie.
You should take that. Yeah. Well, thank you, Seeley. It's been a really fun day talking with people today and being able to visit here. So I certainly really appreciate the invitation, and I'll try not to bore you in the next hour or so. What I am going to talk about is sort of the early story of GFP and then some of the consequence of it. But I want to start in a somewhat strange way, and that is, I want to talk about, this arose because I was asked a few years ago to talk to some high school teachers. And I started thinking about what I was taught in high school, and elementary school for that matter, about what science was. Not actually by being taught, but by all the examples that I was given to hear about Copernicus and Einstein and Newton and Darwin, Fleming and Watt, all the greats in science, hearing their stories, Pasteur and so on. And so I realized that all those stories had given me a particular perspective on science that the GFP story showed was complete nonsense. So I first want to tell you all the myths that I had learned as a boy about what science is and who scientists are. And then I'll tell you the story about GFP as an example to show that all of that was complete nonsense and I shouldn't have listened to any of it. So let me start with the list. What I was taught about scientists in the 1950s and 1960s. The first and foremost things from all these stories about these great scientists is that scientists are geniuses. And there's this innate ability that they have to do this. And it gave me the impression that you either had it or you didn't. So if things didn't work, it meant you didn't have it. And so you should forget about things. Forget about being a scientist. Somehow it was an innate ability. It's not something you worked on and learned, but it was just innate, because scientists were geniuses. And the second point was that scientists' experiments work all the time. And the reason for this is we never had time to tell the complete story, so you just find, get to the punchline, and that's it. But it's not surprising they work all the time, because they're geniuses. And then next is the reason that they're geniuses, and the reason they're scientific experiments work all the time, is that they use this really peculiar way of thinking called the scientific method, where they think about a problem, come up with a hypothesis, figure out the perfect experiment to test that hypothesis. It works the first time, then all the money rolls in. And so that, you had to think in this very peculiar hypothesis-driven way, and that's what the greats did. Now, the other thing about these scientists, and I have to tell you, even though their discovery was in 1953, people were really not talking about Watson and Crick until the early 1960s. They got the Nobel Prize in 62, so it really didn't filter down to the high schools and elementary schools until after that time. So when I was growing up, the basic thing about scientists is they worked alone. Now, they sometimes had an assistant named Igor, but other than that, they were on their own in everything that they did. And the final thing about scientists, from all these examples that I was told, that except for one person, and that was Marie Curie, every one of them was a white man. All Europeans are of European descent. And that's who scientists were and how scientists acted. So the story I'm going to tell you about GFP is going to put a lie to all of this. So my involvement with this rather interesting protein, green fluorescent protein, GFP, started by a seminar that I listened to in 1989. I can actually tell you when I first heard about this. It's sometime afternoon on April the 25th, 1989, talked by a man named Paul Brehm. And I'm sitting in that seminar, and I hear about GFP for the first time, and I'll tell you about that. But I should also tell you why listening and hearing about GFP got me so excited. And for that, I have to tell you just a little bit about the work that was going on in my lab, that it started when I was a postdoc, and still continues to this day. I am interested in the development and function of nerve cells, particularly sensory cells, and particularly the sensory cells that respond to touch. I am the world's foremost authority on tickling worms. And you might ask, why would someone spend their life doing this? Let me try to put this in perspective. There may be no really good reason, but this is at least my reason, is that biologists have known how we interact with the world around us, how our senses detect the outside world. If the signal given by that outside world is radiant, if it comes from light, so we've known about the molecule rhodopsin for about 130 years. We also have known in the last 25 years how we can receive signals from the outside world if those signals are chemical signals, because we understand a lot about the receptors for chemicals, whether it's external signals, odors and tastes, or it's an internal signal like a hormone or a neurotransmitter. We have a pretty good idea how those signals are transduced into an electrical signal eventually in a cell, or a change in the chemistry of the cells. But we have a whole series of senses that work because they're driven by mechanical changes. So the fact that you can hear me is because the hair cells in your inner ear are responding to the sound vibrations. You have other hair cells in the inner ear that respond to acceleration. So when you turn yourself around really quick, or you get on one of those outrageous rides and get spun around and want to go off and vomit, it's because your vestibular apparatus has been activated. We have something on the order of 5 different types of cells in our skin that respond to different modalities of touch. We have stretch receptors in our muscles and tendons that tell you when they are being manipulated. And we have detectors, for example, for blood pressure, all sorts of things that are responding to mechanical signals. And all of these senses, even though they are mediated by many different types of cells, have one thing in common. And that is, we don't have any idea how they work. So this is a great field to go into. And it's really somewhat of a holy grail to find out the sensors, the mechanical sensors. And so I started my postdoc by looking for mutants of the nematode, Centrorhabditis elegans, this beautiful creature is shown here, that were insensitive to touch. You test touch by taking, it's very sophisticated, you take an eyebrow hair, you glue it to a toothpick, and you tickle the animal, and you stroke it across the animal in the head, this is the head, and it goes backwards, you stroke it in the tail, it goes forward, and so we mutated the animals to look for mutants that didn't respond. Now, we have to be a little more sophisticated than this, because dead animals also don't respond. So what we needed to do was to take the animals, and we prod them with a little platinum wire. And even animals that are missing the touch-sensing cells will move if prodded with the wire. So they had to move, but they didn't understand the tickle. So I worked on this for several years, and I really liked doing the genetics in C. elegans, and one of the things that was really important about C. elegans, and you may be able to somewhat detect it here in this picture, is C. elegans is transparent. We can put it under a microscope and see every cell. Now, it's not so easy to see which cells I would point to here, but every cell, every nucleus can be seen using contrast interference microscopy. And so, that was something I said in every single seminar from 1977 up till 1989, so for 12 years. And after 12 years of saying that, I truly believed that this was a transparent animal. So going into that seminar, there were two things that I brought with me. One was the knowledge that I worked on a transparent animal. And two, we had by that time been mutating the animal like mad, mapping out the mutations, identifying the genes, and starting to clone the genes. And when we started to clone the genes, the first question we wanted to ask was, in what cell are these active? What cell turns these genes on? Is it the touch-sensing cell? And so we were very interested in knowing about gene expression. And so when we did our experiments, we could answer that question. And there were a number of methods. For example, because DNA makes RNA makes protein, we could make an antibody against the protein and see what cells expressed it. Or we could use a probe for the RNA and use in situ hybridization and also see which cells were expressing the messenger RNA. Or we could use a reporter system. Malcolm Kasademan in the 1960s had developed the E. coli LacZ gene as a marker of gene expression. If you express this enzyme driven by the appropriate promoter, you could see if a cell was expressing it because you could use a substrate to look at where the enzyme activity was made. And so all of these methods answered the question, what cell turns on the gene? But there were problems with these methods. First of all, they were a lot of work. What we had to do is take the sample, the worms, they had to be killed, fixed, so nothing moved around. And then in order to get the antibody or the DNA probe for the in situs or the enzymatic substrate for the beta-galactosidase activity, we had to permeabilize the sample. So this, out of necessity, sort of stopped the experiment, right? The animals were dead. We were looking at a snapshot in time. We weren't really looking at how things changed. We could do time points. We could prepare things at different times after something that we did to the animals, but that was an enormous amount of work. And then, of course, once we did this, we'd have to do it all over again. So it was quite a lot of work. Before going on and telling you what I heard in that seminar, finally get to that, I want to explain my color code. There are three colors that I use in the names of the people that you'll see pictures of. These two people, Hong Ping Du was a graduate student and then came back for a short time as a postdoc, but started as a graduate student. Shohei Mitani was a postdoc in lab, and those are the ones that did these experiments. Anyone that was in my lab, or is in my lab, their name is going to be in red. Anybody who is a collaborator, their name is going to be in blue. And if you see anyone whose name is in black, which you will on the next slide, that's a person who did something I wish I had done. So, who is that person? One of the people that shared the prize with me, Osamu Shimomura. The seminar that I heard in April was about his, it started off with an introduction about his work with this jellyfish, Aquaria victoria. If you have a half an hour to spare, and I hope you do, please go to the nobelprize.org website and listen to his speech. It's only actually 29 minutes, or read his speech. His story is astonishing. At the age of 16, he's told, that's it, you have to quit high school, you have to work in a factory. So that's it, school's over. He is assigned to work in a paint factory. He has to cross the mountains adjacent to the city he was born in and start working in the factory, which actually turns out not to be so bad because the city is Nagasaki, Japan, and the year is 1945. And by being forced to be on the other side of the mountains when the atomic bomb destroys the city, he's protected. He goes in and helps rescue and help people, but there's no college to go to. There's nothing to go to. And in fact, it took several years before they built, near where he was living, a college that he could go to. He didn't want to go to it, actually. He wasn't really interested in the subject, but it was the only college he could go to, and that was the pharmacy school. So he graduates with an undergraduate degree in pharmacy and goes to get a job as a technician at Nagoya University. And at Nagoya University, he has something done to him that we often do to graduate students and technicians and undergraduates, and that is he's assigned a project that the head of the lab is very excited about, but when the head of the lab actually describes the project, he neglects to say that several other people have tried it and no one got it to work. But the project was fascinating. It was to take a small crustacean called Cypridina and to find out the biochemistry that was the basis of this small crustacean producing a blue light. And there are many organisms that produce light. Quite a number of them, and many different phyla. There's fungi, there's bacteria, there's worms, there's jellyfish, fireflies, so on. And they all produce light biochemically in very different ways. So firefly luciferase had been known, but no one really knew how Cypridina worked. And as I say, several people tried the experiment, didn't work. It worked for Shimomura. He's a very good biochemist. He figured it out. And on the basis of that, two things happened that I know of. The first thing was he was invited to go and work in the United States, which he then did, and that led to his working on the jellyfish. And the second thing is he had a rather unusual going away present from the head of his lab. The head of the lab arranged for him to be given a PhD. Not a bad thing for the job. So he comes to the United States and he works, goes out to Friday Harbor Lab and Washington State, and he starts to try to figure out why it is that this jellyfish produces this beautiful green light. And as he's doing the experiments, and this is where the scientific method comes in, everything fails. He's very good, he's changing all the situation, it fails, he does some more, it fails. He's using up a lot of jellyfish. And it's just not working at all. Day after day after day. You got the idea. It's not working the first time. Finally, one night, he's done the prep again, and it's failed again. And he goes and decides, that's it, I'm going home for dinner. I'm closing up shop. And he takes all the samples that he has, and he throws them in the sink. He's sort of neat. He cleans up. He's throwing the stuff in the sink. Sink also had the overflow of the various tanks that they had to keep the jellyfish and other aquatic organisms. So that's also going into the sink. And he turns off the light, and he's just about to go out the door when he looks back at the sink and he finds that it's glowing brightly. He's a little surprised at that. He goes and looks at the sink for a while and then probably goes home. And then he reasons that the sink had seawater in it. And seawater had something that he had never tried in any of the experiments, and that was calcium. So he goes back several days later, or in the next couple of days, and he redoes the prep, and sure enough, every time he adds calcium, he gets a bolt of light coming out of this. So calcium triggers it. So there's the scientific method, throw it in the sink. Okay. Other biochemists I've heard of have thrown their preps on the floor, picked them up, and then worked, and they work beautifully. There's all sorts of interesting techniques here. But the upshot of it is that he purified a protein that he named after the jellyfish, which was called a quorin. And a quorin plus calcium produced light, which was really sort of interesting. I should say, several years later, other groups said, well, this would be a wonderful thing if we injected a cell with a quorin, then every time the calcium level went up, we would see light in that cell. And so this was the first calcium indicator that came out of this. But as I point up here, that it's a wonderful problem. How does an organism produce light? But there's two accidents. The first was throwing the thing in the sink. The second was when he looked at the light that was produced when he added calcium to a quorin, it was the wrong color. It was blue. The jellyfish give off a green light. So he thought about that for a while and thought maybe there's a molecule that accepts the blue light and converts it to green. And so he goes back to all of his samples with a handheld UV lamp and he looks at all of them and he finds a different fraction, and in fact, the UV light or blue light will activate it and you get green. And he calls this the green protein. And in 1962, when he publishes his paper on the purification of a quorin, one of his footnotes, footnote number 3, says, this is the wrong color, but I found this other thing, the green protein, that seems to be important for this. So that we now call that GFP, green fluorescent protein, and it is what is needed to produce the green light. This footnote, I believe, is the only footnote in history to win its writer a Nobel Prize. So he has a very interesting life and all sorts of things. So I'm listening to a seminar about this. And as I've already told you, I work on a transparent animal. And I'm interested in where genes are active. Okay? And so I'm sitting there, and I'm dumbstruck because I realize if we could get this molecule out, all we'd have to do is shine blue light on it. Green light would show us where it is. It would make a great marker. We wouldn't have to get any substrate in. The substrate, if you will, is light. And that goes through a transparent animal. So I'm ecstatic because I realize it's going to provide a lantern that we can hook onto things and just look, label cells and everything. And I'm really excited. In fact, I'm so excited that I just fantasized for the next hour as I sat in the seminar. I have no idea what the seminar was about. I just was thinking about the experiment. But I was very excited about this idea that there might be a fluorescent protein. I also want to point out something that I think is sort of fair here also with the scientific method. I did not do a series of experiments with all those other methods and say, these are laborious, they're static, I have to kill the animals, this is horrible, let me think of a better way to do this. Ah, you know, if I had a fluorescent protein, that would be great. Now I'm going to find out if there's a fluorescent protein. No, it came to my university and said, here I am. allowed us in. So again, I can't take credit for having you know, this great insight and great long chain of ideas. I was working on an animal. I was looking at gene expression, and somebody told me about this miraculous protein. But for some reason, no one else in that audience thought about this. And we didn't, in fact, publish for 5 years after I heard that seminar. So for 5 years, other people had been hearing this as well. So I have no idea why other people didn't do this, other than to say, I was working on C. elegans. It was transparent. All the rest of the people were working on frogs and mice and other things that were not transparent. And so they didn't think about that. So you got to be really lucky, is, I think, the thing. Anyway, the next day I got so excited, I actually got on the telephone. And I called this guy, Douglas Prasher, found out that Douglas was in the process of isolating the DNA, the cDNA, for GFP. And so we talked for a while, and it was really a lot of fun. We had all these ideas about experiments, and we decided to do a collaboration. Unfortunately, I was on sabbatical. I left soon after that. And so when he called to tell me that he had cloned the gene, I wasn't there. And so he interpreted that as me not being in science anymore. And I, because I didn't get his phone call, interpreted that to mean he had failed to get GFP. And so for 3 years, nothing happened, 3 or 4 years. And then in 1992, a new graduate student came, Gia Skirkin. And Gia had just finished her master's degree in chemical engineering at our engineering school, where she had worked on fluorescence. So I figured if there was ever a sucker I could talk into doing this experiment, it was going to be Gia. So we talked about this experiment, and I said, you know, but unfortunately, Douglas never got back in touch with me, so I don't think it worked. But let's, the university just put Medline, the precursor of PubMed, on our computers. Let's go look and see if there's anything about fluorescent protein. So we look at, and the very first line is Douglas's 1992 paper saying that he, in fact, had gotten the cDNA for GFP. And we ran down to the library, got the issue of the journal out, and looked at it, and it had a really unusual thing as part of the article. It had his new phone number. So we could actually call him up because he had moved. And so I called him up and, you know, went through the thing of, no, didn't you drop out of science? No, didn't you not? You know, we got that all sorted out. And we renewed the thing. And a couple days later, he sent us a sample of the DNA that Gia could then put into bacteria. And so that first, after only 1 month as a first-year graduate student, this is a page from her lab notebook, and I've circled the part that says strongly fluorescing E. coli, because she had put the gene into E. coli. This is, in fact, an example of the experiment that does work the first time. And that turned out to be amazingly lucky for us. And let me try to explain that. But I also want to first point out another interesting line on this page from her lab notebook, where it says that she used the microscope from engineering. Now, the reason for this, remember I told you she had gotten a master's degree working on fluorescence in our engineering school, and that's right next to us in the biology department. She took the bacteria, and this is a picture she took on that very first night. She took the sample of the bacteria that she had put GFP in, and she wasn't really sure that they were fluorescent looking at our microscope in my lab. And that was because at that time, the microscope we had was a piece of junk. Had too much glass in the optical path. But she knew where a better microscope was, and so she went to her old lab, she looked at that, and that's where she took the picture. I'm very grateful for her for doing that. Because she wasn't sure on that, but she was absolutely sure when she looked at the other through the other microscope. But you can see the dilemma. We've just shown that we have a way of marking cells fluorescently. But we don't have a microscope to look at them. So the way I solved this problem is I called up all the sales representatives for microscope companies that were in New York City, and I said, look, we've just developed a new way of looking at gene expression. We're very excited about this. We are definitely going to buy a new fluorescence microscope because the old one's a piece of junk, but we don't know which one we should buy. Do you think you could bring a microscope by that we could test out, bring a loaner? And if you could leave it for a month or two, we could probably give it a really good workout. And so if you look in our paper, there's a footnote that lists, you can see GFP fluorescence, and it lists a whole bunch of microscopes. Those were the loaners or other things that we used in other people's departments. So everything was done on loaner microscopes. But we were very excited about this. Now, I mentioned that this experiment worked the first time, and it worked in E. coli. If you asked at that time of anyone that knew anything about green fluorescent protein, they would tell you that our experiment was stupid and should not really be done. And the reason for that is people knew quite a lot about GFP. They knew it had no requirement for any exogenous component. There was no other, you know, cofactor that was needed. But GFP underwent a really interesting modification. And that modification is, I'm going to diagram it here. So this is part of the peptide backbone. Okay, the long chain that all the amino acids are hooked up on. The mature protein, however, takes these five atoms and makes a five-membered ring. And no one had any idea how this five-membered ring was made. They did know, however, that it was absolutely essential for the molecule to become fluorescent. So there was a modification. And everybody that worked on, in this area said there has to be a converting enzyme, or maybe two, or maybe even more converting enzymes that would allow the biochemistry to take place so that this unusual fluorescent protein would be made. So the experiment, according to everyone else, should not have been done. And even if it were done, it was not going to work. And by GIA showing that it worked, it said, this conversion doesn't require anything else. It's, in a sense, autocatalytic. The enzyme itself is its own converting enzyme, or the protein itself. Now, I found out that three other groups also had the idea of looking at GFP as a marker. And they also got the DNA from Douglas Prasher, which I've diagrammed here, and really you just look at the bottom. So the DNA that Douglas had isolated had the green part here, which is the coding sequence for GFP, and it had the red parts, which are other jellyfish DNA. And this was isolated and cut out with the restriction enzyme EcoR1 and then put into a vector. The other three groups were careful. They were precise. We were sloppy, not very precise. I think there's a lesson in here because let me tell you what happened. They wanted to make sure that the sequence was correct. And so when they put it in whatever organism they were going to test, they wanted to make sure the sequence was unchanged. And in 1992, when you did those experiments, if you wanted to make sure your DNA sequence was correct, you cut things out with restriction enzymes, you put them into vectors, and you grew them up in bacteria, so you get many copies of them. I didn't like the fact that there was these extra bits that I knew nothing about. And so I suggested to Gia that she not make the experiment, do the experiment in that way, but rather to take PCR primers, diagrammed here, and just copy exactly the coding sequence and leave all the other junk away from the coli that she was going to put this in. And my reasoning for this was, we're going to put this in bacteria. There's millions and millions of bacteria. Do we care if some of the sequence is bad? And PCR often made bad sequence. But did we care? If we got one bacterium that was green, we were set. So I said, I just don't like the other junk. Leave that out. The other three groups were careful. They used restriction enzymes. And we don't know the reason for this, but if you leave those red bits out on, it doesn't work. Of course, as I've already told you, if it doesn't work, you never say, it's my fault. You always say, there must be a converting enzyme here. Must be something else. But because GIA just amplified the green bits, it meant that we had this thing working the first time. So the fact that it worked the first time was really sort of essential, because if it hadn't worked, we probably would have said, oh, there's a converting enzyme, and go through a lot of nonsense like that. But so we were very fortunate. And then we put it into worms, and then we decided we would publish. And we did publish the paper in Science in 1994. I want to say a little bit about scientific publishing, because it's on a lot of people's minds, and tell you some of the problems we had trying to get this stuff in print. So the first problem was that was the journal Science, to be very frank. Now, the journal Science is read by many, many people, and I didn't want to send the paper to a neuron-specific or neurobiology-specific journal or a cell biology-specific journal or a developmental biology-specific journal. I wanted as many people as possible working in many different fields to see what this was about, because I was very excited about this. And so I decided I would send it to Science, because at the time I thought it had the largest publication audience. And so I sent it in, but some of you may know that the journal Science and the editors at the journal think exceptionally highly of the journal. So much so that they will not just take your paper and say, thank you, we're sending it out for review. They have to think about it. They have to decide, is this paper worthy enough, not for publication, but for review? And they called me up and they said, well, we sort of liked your paper, but we're not sending it out for review. And I said, why not? What's wrong with the paper? And they said, well, you see, the thing we don't like is the title. And I said, oh, you gotta be kidding. And they said, no, you see, your title. I said, what's wrong with that? I said, green fluorescent protein, a new marker for gene expression. Succinct, it does everything. They said, well, you see, the problem with your title is that because everything in the journal Science is new, you cannot use that word in the title. So we won't send the paper out. And I said, if I change the title, how's that? And they said, I think they actually said maybe. So I have to admit to you that I don't like being told what to do. I think that's why I'm a scientist. And so I was a little bit miffed, and so the title I sent back with the paper for the review was a bit extensive. The Aquaria Victoria green fluorescent protein needs no exogenously added component to produce a fluorescent product in prokaryotic and eukaryotic cells. And the reviewers liked it, and they accepted the paper. And then I got this call from the copy editor, and the copy editor said, do you know that your title is a bit long? And I said, yeah, I think I do. And she said, is there any possibility that you could make this title shorter? And I said, let me think about it. How about this, green fluorescent protein as a marker for gene expression? She said, oh, that's wonderful. So that was it. That's the official title. The next problem we had has to do with this picture, which I sent in. This is a newly hatched worm, and what I really wanted this picture, why I wanted it on the cover, is I wanted it to show this nerve cell with its growth cone as it was growing out, to give the idea that you could watch living organisms and watch what was happening in development. So I was very excited about this, and I thought the picture would be terrific, and then the cover editor calls me up and says, we really like your picture. However, there is one problem, and that is there's one color that we really never like to use on the cover because it really doesn't reproduce well, and that's green. Is it possible for us to change the color? Which I said, no, I really don't think so. And this is somewhat enhanced. So if you actually go back and actually look at this, it really does look sort of washed out. But nonetheless, I just couldn't imagine like a paper on green fluorescent protein and have the cell in blue or pink or something like that. But it worked. The third problem we had arose from the fact that we had already been giving away samples of GFP DNA to people to try in their own systems, and people were getting back to me and saying, you know, it works in our system, dictyostelium, or it works in yeast, or it works in these other organisms. This is great. Mammalian cells in culture, I think even human cells in culture, it's working. And so I wanted to cite this work, saying it's not just jellyfish and E. coli, it's in all these other organisms. And so I wrote these people and I said, look, do you mind if I cite your work, your unpublished work? And they said, you gave us GFP way before you published it. Of course you can. That's perfectly fine. And so there's a footnote that actually lists all these different results. There's an incredible, the paper is half footnotes, by the way. In any case, there was one person that gave me a hard time. And that is this person here. And I'm sure you can't read the letter, so I've written out the important salient points. The demands were that I make coffee every Saturday for 2 months at 8:30. I would prepare a special French dinner at a time of my choosing, and I would take out the garbage nightly for a month. This is my wife. But what Tula did was truly amazing. And in fact, her paper came out about 4 months after our paper. She was really the first person, and it was not because I hounded her in this, but it was surprising. Nobody in my department, when we did this stuff on GFP, took any interest in it at all. And a lot of people didn't. Tula was the first person that said, this is great, I want to use it. And what she did was something really spectacular. What we had done, you know, genes basically have two parts to them, right? They have the part that encodes for the product. And then they have the part that says where, when, and how much, the controlling thing. And we took that controlling region and we put GFP on it, so wherever the gene was expressed, GFP would be made. What she did is she took the whole gene, both parts, and then tacked on GFP, the GFP coding sequence, after the normal coding sequence. So GFP now was really the lantern on the caboose of the protein, and wherever the protein went, you could see it because of GFP. And I work on worms, she works on flies. There's a little household thing in terms of that. But what she does is she looks at the development of the oocyte, and she had a protein she was interested in that was made by what are called the nurse cells that goes through these canals and then comes to line up on this edge and on this edge of the oocyte. And she was able to show that she could make a protein fusion. And this was the first time this was done. She also did a very nice control. Because how do you know that what you're seeing is actually correct? So what she did is her fusion protein, her protein plus GFP, was put into an animal that didn't have the protein, was a mutant that didn't have it. It rescued the animal's phenotype. Everything was normal, but then you could see the GFP. So that rescuing was exceptionally important. So it was a very important experiment. She claims I have never paid up on this. I believe I have in other ways. One ridiculous story. Several months after the Nobel Prize was announced, I went into our local pharmacy, and one of the pharmacists came up to me and said, aren't you the guy that got that Nobel Prize? And I said, yes. He said, congratulations. I said, thank you. A couple months after that, my wife went into the pharmacy, and I don't know if it was the same guy or it was a different person, comes up to her and says, wait a minute, aren't you the wife of that guy that won the Nobel Prize? She said, yes. And he said, he looks at her and he says, I loved your letter. In any case, why was GFP then so popular afterwards? Here's some of the reasons. The first thing is you get GFP into an organism because you can put the gene in. You take the DNA, and once you put that into an organism, it and all its subsequent progeny have it. So it's inherited. And so you can do this once, and then you have an organism that has cells or proteins or tissues lit up, and you can then use them for other experiments. Second, instead of having to kill the animal, permeabilize it, do all this horrible stuff to it, and then try to see what you have, the only thing you have to do with this animal is you shine blue light on it. And blue light is fairly innocuous to cells. So it's a rather almost non-invasive way of looking at biology. Third, it's actually fairly small. Compared to beta-galactosidase, which I showed on an earlier slide, it's only 1/16th the molecular weight. And that means GFP can diffuse all through the cell. Beta-galactosidase cannot. It stays usually in the cell body unless you use some tricks. And finally, as I've pointed out several times, you can use this to look at living tissue and living organisms. And this ability to have this dynamic view of life has proven to be exceptionally important. To give you some examples of where GFP has been put in, here's the entire nervous system of the worm that we work in GFP. Here is a canola plant, Drosophila, mice, zebrafish. You can actually buy these in pet stores now. And this is Alba, the GFP bunny. Alba was commissioned by the Brazilian artist Eduardo Koch, who lives in Chicago, because he wanted to go to his various art shows with Alba, which he did, to stimulate conversations of the connection between art and science and art and technology. On the right-hand side here, I have a few cells, some fibroblasts in culture. These are Drosophila cells. This is the mustard plant, Arabidopsis. And here's a Purkinje cell from a mouse brain. And you can see that the GFP has outlined all the various branches of the cell. Now, I want to show you a couple movies and just to refresh everyone's ideas about what I'm going to be showing. I'm going to show you the early development in Drosophila. Now, there is no cell division in the early development of Drosophila, so this diagram's not very good. But there is nuclear division, the nuclei divide. And so in one of the movies, GFP has been added to beta tubulin, which is part of the spindle. And so you're going to see, as the cell undergoes mitosis, or the nucleus undergoes mitosis, you're going to see the spindle forming. And then go away, and then another round, you'll see another spindle. And both movies that I'm going to show you are time-lapse. They've been really speeded up. Development doesn't happen this quickly, but we have a limited amount of time here. The other movie I'm going to show you is with a small peptide attached to GFP, which is called a nuclear localization signal. If there is a nucleus, then the GFP, in this case, will be sucked up into the nucleus. When mitosis takes place, the GFP will go all over the embryo. And then as the nuclei reform, it will come back into them. So let me show you the movie so you get an idea of this dynamic view of what happens. So on the left, both of these were by a graduate student from Canada named Rosalind Silverman-Gavrilo, who I've never met, but she kindly put both of the movies on the website of the American Society for Cell Biology, and that's where I got them from. One on the left, black and white, but it's of GFP, and let me just run it. See the spindle forming, and then going away. It's going to go very fast. Spindles reform, and so on. You'll see this happen two more times, and as you look at this, I think the most obvious thing that occurs to everyone is everything is synchronous. It's all happening at the same time. And so the question really is, how does that synchrony come about? In fact, she named this movie In Synchrony. And so we know a lot about cell cycle control and what's happening, and all these nuclei are actually dividing at the same time. So an interesting question that comes about because you get a chance to look at things changing over time. Now, the movie on the right is colored, but it's false color. It's just GFP. And the false color convention is as you go on the rainbow from the purple to the blue to the yellow and orange, or purple to blue to green, the yellow to orange to red, you're going to get more and more material. So these nuclei here have a little, these have a little bit more, these have the most, and then again, a little bit in these things. So let me show you that. So nuclei break down. Now it's everywhere in the embryo. The nuclei are going to start reforming, and the GFP is going to be sucked up into them. And then they're going to break down as they go through another round of cell division again, or nuclear division, again, all over the place. Now here, you see that this is not synchronous, that there's actually a wave of this happening in the picture going from the lower right to the upper left, as you see here. And so the question is, why is this different? What's wrong here? Or what's happening here? And the thing is, there's something wrong here. We suspect that the cover slip was a little too heavy on this embryo. And so it actually was distorting the development. But this is a very sensitive way of looking at something distorting the development of the animal that didn't occur in the example on the right. GFP has been used in a lot of different ways. I like to divide them up into three areas: fundamental, applied, and the unexpected. You might say the weird. So for fundamental, to give some examples, it's been, as I mentioned, used to look at gene expression, to look at protein localization, to use in mutational analysis. Because once you can label something, then you can look for changes in that pattern. For our sick cells and the touch cells, we can look to see for more cells, less cells, cells in the wrong place, cells that grow out differently, all sorts of things that can go wrong because we can label the cells. We can look at the cells, watch normal development, see things go. We can use this labeling of cells to isolate the cells and then study those cells in isolation. And people have used this to look at brain circuitry, for example, and to look at organismal interactions and so on by labeling one or another or one set of cells as opposed to another. So with regard to applied, certainly been applied a lot in terms of medical problems and issues, taking cancer cells in mice and looking to see where those cancer cells go as the cancers metastasize, being able to look at what happens to the AIDS virus as it gets transmitted from one cell to another, looking at problems of inherited diseases by looking to see what those proteins encoded by the mutated genes do, to looking at the process of infection or parasitism and so on. It's also been used in biotechnology, it's been used for drug discovery, and it's been used for biosensors, and I'll show you an example of a biosensor that I'm quite intrigued about. And then there's the unexpected, the things that most of these I guessed at, that people would study these things. There are other things that I'm still astonished about that people did. I didn't anticipate all the biosensors, but some of them. So there's been new research. Group in Moscow, the Lukianovs and Mikhail Matz, these people loved scuba diving. And they knew that corals were fluorescent because of all the scuba diving they did. And they wondered whether the fluorescence in the coral was similar to the fluorescence, if there was a fluorescent protein similar to GFP. Because they knew that some corals actually fluoresced red. And no one had been able to make a red fluorescent protein. And so they just went off and isolated the coral protein. And sure enough, that was a red fluorescent protein. And people have gone back to the sea a lot to find organisms that are fluorescent in many different ways and give us a whole new set of tools that I would not have imagined. I should have, but I didn't. Carl Dieseroff, who's been one of the leaders in what's called optogenetics, once told me that the reason he got excited in trying to see if there was something like channel rhodopsin, which is a molecule that you can activate by light and it'll activate nerve cells, is because of the success of GFP. He said that was sort of the thing that stimulated him to go and look at this as a new tool. And there's been new chemistry is. People have thought, how does this protein work? How does this fluorescence derive here? I put the word industry down there because soon after the Nobel, I was asked by the board of directors of the Woods Hole Marine Biology Lab to come and talk to them, and I gave a talk, and at the end of my talk, Jim Sharp, the president of Zeiss Microscopes in the United States, came up, made a little presentation. And he said, Marty, you don't know this, but in 1994, 1993, before your paper came out, Zeiss was seriously considering stopping the production of fluorescent microscopes. And then your paper came out and everyone needed one, and so we're still in the business. And I said, so that means you're giving me a microscope. And he said, no. I'm going to show you the example of GFP in art. I've already shown you ALBA, but I'll show you another one later. In our lab, we've used GFP to look where genes are expressed. So here's two genes that we picked out because getting rid of the genes produces touch insensitivity. One is in the touch-sensing cells, and only in the touch-sensing cells. The other is in muscle. So now we're trying to figure out what that connection is between these cells. We have made protein fusions, so we can look at where. This is actually the transducer, the molecule that senses touch. And you can see that it's not uniform here. It's in this dotted appearance in the cell. You may not be able to make this out. If we could have the lights out down here, that might be slightly better. But we can isolate cells and study them in isolation. Just the touch cells, because we isolate it from this animal, where only the touch cells have GFP in them. And we can look for mutants. It may be a little hard to see here, but these cells normally have a single process. Here's a cell where the process comes out and then branches into two. So we can look for all sorts of variants that help us study the basic fundamental principles of the development of nerve cells here. So we're very excited. Now, the problem with GFP, as far as anyone else is concerned, I have no problem with GFP. But other people just get greedy. And they get greedy and they say, well, you gave it to us in green. That's nice. I want more colors. And the person who really did most of the modifications and really improved GFP, both the intensity of the fluorescence and also the colors, was the third person to share the prize, which is Roger Chen. And he's shown here with some of the colors his lab developed. These were all, he got tired of calling them by letters. And so he decided to call them by colors, by fruits. And so I think this is blueberry, and that's melon, and that's lime, and that's, I think, banana, I'm not sure. Orange, and that's either tomato or cherry. It's one of the others. He's got about 14, 15 of these that really span the entire spectrum. And when you have something that spans the entire spectrum, and you take four of them that sort of that fit in all the various places, and you mix and match them, you can get any color that you want. And this is what Josh Shanes and Jeff Lichtman did at Harvard several years ago, because what they wanted to do was to label every single cell in the mouse brain. So if you're going to do something that you're going to label every cell in the central nervous system of a mouse, and you got to use all the colors of the spectrum, there's actually only one word for that can be called, and that's brainbow. And these are some of the pictures that they have. And the pictures are really striking. I mean, it's really quite wonderful. And you know there's a big initiative to understand the circuitry of the mammalian brain, and this is a very important tool in that. I have no idea what the time is, but I think I should probably skip this next slide, which I will quickly. Unfortunately, there's a lot of parts to skip on this slide. One more. There. So I want to get to the medical example. The way we usually teach to undergraduates about viruses is usually to look at bacterial viruses, and bacterial viruses that cause lysis, cells to break open and spew out the virus so that they can infect other cells. So the sort of simple view of viruses is that a virus made in a cell, the cell opens up, it gets spewed out. But if that's the case, if you had an antibody against the virus, it could sort of scarf up all the virus particles. They could be eliminated from the system. This would be a good thing. So we'd make a vaccine. That's if that's what happens to the virus. But you know, it's been very hard to come up with a virus against HIV. And one of the reasons is shown in this movie. So here's a cell in which the virus proteins are labeled with GFP. And this is actually associating with another cell here. And there's the particle. And it's not going outside the cell. It just goes from inside one to inside the other, profoundly changing the way you think about how you might control this. That maybe the association of the cells is really the important thing to interfere with, and so on. So again, this ability to look at the process as it's occurring, to have this dynamic view, is exceptionally important. I talked about biosensors. I'm going to tell you my favorite. Actually, Roger started sort of a mini industry when he used the two colors and used what was called FRET, which is the slide I went through, to get biosensors that could detect calcium or pH change or redox changes or enzymatic activities in cells. But another type of sensor was made by a guy named Bob Berledge. Bob had this interesting idea. He was at the time at Oak Ridge National Laboratory. And he had this interesting idea. He knew that there was a bacterial gene that got activated in the presence of the explosive TNT. So, you know, it sounds like sort of like one of those afternoon chemistry, you know, experiments to blow up your house thing. But he decided to make a bacterium that would have that control element that would be turned on in the presence of TNT, but it would turn on the production of GFP. So whenever there was TNT in the plates that he used, he didn't use a lot in the plates, just some TNT in the plates, the coli would glow green when you shone blue light on them. And because he was at Oak Ridge National Lab, and I guess they have access to these things there, he also knew that landmines that have TNT in them leak it. And so he had a friend get 5 landmines and bury them in a 3-meter by 5-meter plot of land. He sprayed the area with his bacteria and then came back at night with a UV lamp and was able to see where the landmines had been buried. Now, to me, this is an astonishing experiment. It didn't work all the time, but I know of at least 2 other groups that have confirmed this. The idea of being able to use GFP as a way to detect landmines, things that kill innocent people, and often well after the combatants have left the area, and so that no one would be hurt, I think is just an incredibly wonderful idea. Now, it doesn't always work. There may be plant proteins that stimulate this system as well. So there's a refinement that's needed, and I'm sure somebody's working on it. But I like the idea because it shows the ingenuity of people trying to say, what can we do to help? How can we apply science in a way to help? Another unusual thing in industry that I've found out about recently, I went to Japan, and you know in Japan, they have a very famous and old silk industry. Well, they have put GFP and RFP and other fluorescent proteins into fibrin and silk protein, and then grew up silk moths and made some fluorescent clothing out of them as well. And I mentioned art. So I told you about ALBA. Let me tell you about another thing, which actually may be, it's a claim that this is actually the first transgenic human. Right? Because GFP has been put into archaea and bacteria and plants and invertebrates and vertebrates, all sorts of organisms, except people, except for this one instance where it's claimed that this person is a transgenic human. And if you look at the beginning of the Ang Lee movie Hulk, you will see in the opening credits a jellyfish bobbing along, and a hypodermic needle comes in and sucks out the GFP. And then there's a lab notebook that talks about aquaria, and bioluminescence and everything. But the idea is that somehow Bruce Banner, as a little baby, gets an injection of GFP DNA way before I did my experiments. And it somehow got inserted into a gene that's activated by anger, that every time it's turned on, his skin turns green. So my lab told me about this. I was ecstatic. I thought, this is terrific. And it turns out that the screenwriter, James Shamus, is somebody that I know because his daughter, my daughter, went to school together. He's at Columbia in the film department, or the film school, in the School of the Arts. And so I went to him and I said, James, I saw Hulk. It's fantastic. This is wonderful. How did you know about my work? And he said, I have no idea what you do. And I said, oh, that stuff with the GFP. And he said, oh, that. We had a kid from MIT working on the set, and he suggested it. I said, fine with me. So let me close with another list. But this is the list of the things that I've learned about GFP. I'm not going to go over that previous list. I hope you've seen how all the examples that I've given put a lie to those various myths that I learned as a young kid. But I want to give you a new list of what I think the GFP story and my research in general has taught me. So the first item is that scientific success comes in by many different routes. I've told you Osamu Shimomura's story. Roger Chen's story is that as a high school student, he actually won the Westinghouse Science Talent Shirts, which is now called the Intel Science Talent Shirts Project. He was really one of the most astonishing high school young scientists that we had. And so he was already showing incredible promise as a youngster and continued to do so throughout his life, continues to do so now. I am not going to show you my grades. Okay? I will just tell you that I did show them a few years ago at a college reunion because they asked me to give a talk. And what I got afterwards is I think virtually every single person at the reunion came up to me to thank me for showing my grades, because they said, almost all of them said the same sentence. They said, for 40 years I've been embarrassed about my grades. Now because you've shown yours, I don't feel so bad. I would say that many, if not most, discoveries are accidental. There's a wonderful line by the physicist Enrico Fermi that goes something on the order of, if you do an experiment and it confirms your hypothesis, then you have made a measurement. But if it doesn't confirm your hypothesis, then you've made a discovery. So an awful lot, if you go through, the Nobel Prize is given really for work that has changed the way people think about things or the way people do experiments. Fortunately, GFP has done that. The estimate is there's been about 160,000 papers that have used fluorescent proteins in the 20 years since we published our paper. Things that have changed things. By that very nature, you really don't know that you're going to change something. And so while some people do discover things and there is the logical process, you read through the biographies of people that have won the Nobel and you hear the word luck and happenstance and we just happen to notice and all questions like that, because serendipity is really important and being able to see that. However, you got to do a lot of things to get the accident to happen. Right? You have to do a lot of things. The next thing is, I think it's really important to be ignorant. I didn't say stupid, I said ignorant, stubborn, and just have a willingness to try things. You gotta just try as many things as possible. And you can't let people talk you out of the experiment. Now, there is a tradition in science that I would call the weekend experiment. This is an experiment where you have a crazy idea. It's so crazy you're embarrassed to say it to anybody. So you sneak into the lab Friday night, Saturday morning, Sunday night, sometime on the weekend when no one else is around, and you do the experiment because it's just gnawing at you. If it works, Monday morning comes, you just crow about it, right? You're so excited about the result. If it doesn't work, you just ask people how their weekends went. But you have to give it a try. And as my friend Oliver Smithy says, one interesting thing about laboratory work is it's play. You go in, you play, and just see what happens, to just try different things. So the next thing to talk about is that the idea that science progress is really cumulative. The Nobel Prize is given for 3 people, but I've shown you, I hope, evidence that at least 6 people, the 3 of us that actually got the prize, my wife Tula Hazelrig, Gia Skirkin, who did the first experiments, and certainly Douglas Prasher, all have a claim to having been exceptionally important in the initial work on GFP. And I think almost any of them, could have been chosen. I'm sort of sorry my wife wasn't chosen. Terrific. But even those 6 don't even begin to describe the hundreds, in fact now thousands, of people that have used GFP and made it better by all the work that they've done. So in fact, I view GFP as a pretty nice model for how we act as scientists. Because just as GFP absorbs light of one wavelength and converts it into light of another wavelength, we take on the observations and results from other people, change them by our own experiments and thoughts, and then give them off to other people so they can do the same thing in turn. And it's this constant chain of people changing results and adding to them that actually makes them important. It's not that the 3 of us did anything so spectacular, it's the fact that thousands of people saw the usefulness of this molecule and made it even better in this. My next point, it's going to sound like an advertisement, but university and grant support were essential for GFP. Let me explain what I mean by this. I told you already I don't like to be told what to do. I can tell you that Columbia University doesn't care a bit about what I do in the lab. I can do anything I want in the lab, as long as it works and I keep bringing in the grant money. But they don't tell me what to do. And for me, that's very important. This is not to denigrate work that's done in industry that has more of a purpose and can often change, but it's just not my style. Because really terrific work has been done in industry. But I really like the freedom that I get in a university setting. And the point about saying grant support is I think people outside the sciences do not understand what our funding situation is. And I'm not talking about we need more money or anything. I don't think they understand what we do with regard to asking for money for our research. What we don't do, and I think the people outside of science think this is what we do, is we don't make a contract. A contract is, here are the 4 things that I promise to do if you pay me. If you pay me, I will do those 4 things. We don't do that. We don't have a contract. We say, here are the 4 things that right now are really important to do. And if you agree with me that I've made a good case for getting this support, then please support this. And then there's the unwritten part that says, if something better comes along tomorrow, I'm going to drop these like a hot potato and I'm going to do something else. Somebody develops GFP. If someone develops CRISPR-Cas9, I'm going to use that because I can do the experiments better. And then in 4 years, after when I have to renew, you tell me whether I've done appropriate, if I've used the money appropriately. And that freedom to change things and not make, you'd be an idiot to write a grant and 5 years later do an experiment only because you wrote it in the proposal. No one would do that. It'd be a waste of money. But I don't think people understand this, that grants, that there's a freedom, there's a trust here of what we do. And it's important for us to work for that trust, but it nonetheless is a trust and allows us a freedom that we needed. We never wrote a grant about GFP. We just did the experiments. We couldn't have gotten a grant for GFP. Others tried. They didn't get them. The reason is there's no preliminary data. There's no evidence to say that it will work. In fact, if you look in the literature, they say, oh, no, this won't work at all. These guys are idiots. Don't do that. So we couldn't write a grant. We could just do the experiments. Well, it's done. When I started giving away samples of GFP, the people that called me up were the heads of labs. That seems to be the job of the head of the lab, is to make the phone calls. But they almost invariably started their conversation with the sentence that went, a sentence that went something like, I've been talking to my postdocs, or I've been talking to my students, and they tell me you're working on something called GFP, and they want it. Why? And I'd explain to them why their students and their postdocs wanted this, and they'd say, oh yeah, that's good, yeah, okay. Can we get it? And I'd say, sure, and I'd send it on. So, in fact, the graduate students, the undergraduates, and the postdocs were the real drivers of scientific innovation in labs. That's been the case in my lab for an enormously long time. It continues to be. And I think it's a very important thing to know. It's not something that filters down from the top. We're all collaborating on doing things, and it's all adding to what makes the work that we do better. Next to last point. This all started with someone looking at bioluminescence in a jellyfish. Not your standard model organism. In fact, not a model organism at all. But something that allowed Shimomura to ask a really fascinating biological question. How is it that some organisms can generate light? And he found this incredible protein that 30 years later, we were able to show actually was a pretty useful tool. His paper was published in a journal about bioluminescence. I'm sure that anyone at that time would have looked at it and said, this is not important research. Why should we care about jellyfish? It's turned out to be exceptionally important research, extreme impact. But it took a while for us all to realize it, but it was very important. So I think all life should be studied, not just model organisms, that we should be expanding our views as much as possible. And the last point I want to make is that fundamental research, basic research, is absolutely essential. These days, there are urgent calls for translational medicine, translational research, of applying what we've learned in the laboratory for cures and preventive measures that can help in human health. And that's incredibly important. I'm not saying that that's wrong. However, I was not the first person to say this. Many people have said, if you want to do translational research, you need to have something to translate. And it's the basic research, the fundamental research, that gives us those, that information that allows us to apply this. And so if you look at the National Institute of Neurologic Disease and Stroke, Story Landis just had a study out where she looked and she asked how much basic research was supported 20 years ago. And it turned out that she could, by going through the absolute, what you call basic research, was 40% of the grants. And she asked, what is it now? And it was 20%. So we're going in the wrong direction, I feel. We still have so much to learn. Most of the genes in the human genome are still listed as making proteins of unknown function. We have no idea what they do. There's so much more for us to learn in general. And to say that we should just do applied things. Now, as I get older, I sort of like the applied things, I have to say. But we really need to have this foundation on which to do the translational research. And so I'd like to leave you with my favorite quote about basic research that was said in 1969 by Robert Wilson, physicist. He's the person that designed the Fermi lab in Batavia, Illinois. And this lab was the world's largest particle accelerator until the CERN super collider was developed, came online a couple years ago. And this lab, the Fermi lab, produced an amazing amount of results in physics, applied to medicine, all sorts of different areas. But in 1969, US Congress was debating whether they should support this big science project. And they had a joint science committee from the House and Senate. And Senator John Pastore from Rhode Island chaired it and brought Dr. Wilson to describe the importance of this particle accelerator. And Pastore was very much in favor of this. And so he thought it would make it easy on Wilson. He said, Dr. Wilson, could you please tell the committee, could you tell us how many things will be developed from this that will help national security? Now you have to remember, it's 1969, it's the middle of the Vietnam War. National security was something people were thinking about a lot. And Wilson stepped up to the microphone and said, none. Pastore was not expecting that answer. And so he asked this question again. Got the same answer, none. And finally, Pastore said, now look, in what respect will this accelerator aid the national defense? And Wilson said the following. It has only to do with the respect with which we regard one another, the dignity of men, our love of culture. It has to do with whether we are good painters, good sculptors, great poets. I mean all the things we really venerate in our country and are patriotic about. It has nothing to do directly with defending the country, except to make it worth defending. Thank you very much. Scared everybody. Yes.
So, in your view, what would you consider potential information that we give you and what you think?
So, in the work that we've done, there sometimes, you know, because GFP is not minuscule. It's 238 amino acids. So although it folds up in this wonderful lantern-like structure, it still is a bulky component. And you sometimes wonder whether putting it on a protein and looking where the protein goes, whether that will interfere in some way. Sometimes people have seen, they say, oh, I express GFP and there's all sorts of problems in the cells. But then again, if you overexpress any protein, you get a lot of problems in cells. And so people usually, when they stop overexpressing it, they usually get something else. They lose those problems. So I don't think it has a particular problem like that. Basically, it's perfect. I mean, it's very useful. So you always want to, if something could be a little stronger, but it's an incredibly efficient molecule. I mean, the GFP molecule. So the efficiency of a molecule, a fluorescence molecule, is how many photons coming in give rise to light that comes out. And GFP has probably one of the highest numbers. It's 90%. So it's exceptionally efficient. So that the substrate, incoming blue light, gets converted to green very readily. And so it's actually very useful. It's a little harder when you start to look at single molecules levels. But people have been able to look at that as well. So I think we are seeing single molecule work done with single GFP molecules. At the moment, there's just too many good things with it. I can't badmouth my baby. Yes?
The painters get ultra-straight gold. This looks like
Yeah?
Yeah.
And there's something wrong with that?
No, it's just that I didn't really understand what it was.
Oh, when all the nerve cells were in different colors? Is that what you were?
Yeah, what those big things.
So, let me try to get to Brainbow. Whoops. Oh, I don't know what I did, but I don't. I'll get back to it. There we go. There we are. One of the things that people really are interested in, our brains have something on the order of 100 billion nerve cells. A small number. And so the question is, in that brain, and you see a cell, where does it go? Where is it connected to another cell? And if you just looked at the brain and couldn't tell the difference among the cells, you couldn't tell where the cell went. But now, if you have a cell labeled in blue or the one in green, you could just follow that through the sample and say, oh, look, the green one splits in the two and it's on this process. And you can follow that through the brain and try to see where all the wires are connected. It's sort of like going into an old television or an old radio, which you probably never listened to, but and actually ask the question, how is everything connected? And this gives us a chance to follow the connections, to follow this red nerve cell or this light blue nerve cell and ask, do they do the same thing? Do they go to the same place? Do they split in different ways? How are they connected to other cells that come close to them? That's one of the reasons one would like to label everything and then take a look. Now, unraveling what happens to all those nerve cells is pretty hard, but people are trying to do this now, to just find out how different parts of the brain are connected to each other. I hope that's answered your question. Yes?
How long does the luminescence last past the presence of ambient light?
So the actual fluorescence from a single photon is actually very, very short. Because what you're doing is you're exciting the molecule to a higher energy state. That energy state is coming, that comes back down and you get a photon coming out. So that a single event is there. But usually, and I think what you're asking about is what happens if you continue to shine light, can you continue to get the other color out? And GFP turns out to be an exceptionally stable protein. And the fluorescence actually lasts for a very long time. So it's very stable. It does not photobleach. There is eventually some photobleaching, but it's a very stable protein. So you can look over long periods of time. And certainly, if you don't have the light on it all the time, you can look, turn it off, wait a couple minutes, look again, and keep seeing the same cell, for example, in an organism. So you can see it over a very long period. Yeah?
Why do you think there's been sort of a shift away from basic research questions?
Now you want me to put myself on a line here. I'm now going to antagonize several people in the audience. The answer is I'm not sure. I think one thing is that this idea of translation sells. It's very, I like it. Everybody likes it. No one would say, I'm against curing something. The problem is, it's not usually the case that working directly on, what should we do with the patient and using the science, it's usually by very indirect routes. And I can give you a good example of that. But so I think that's a problem. But I think, and maybe this is me being paranoid, so I apologize before saying this, but I think that there's been a very dramatic change in the last 30 years in our medical schools. And that change has been that doctors have gone from being gods to being employees of health insurance companies. I think there's been a lot of a sort of a drop in respect. I think there's also at the same time been an incredible increase in the amount of really astonishing work that's come out of molecular biology and basic research. And so in my more paranoid moods, I think that part of this is, let's get more money for the doctors in the medical school, okay? So as I said, I'm gonna say something nice here, but I think that there is a push for that. This is, I've said at the beginning, I'm gonna repeat, I'm not against translational research. I'm against the shift away from basic research. When the supplement money, the stimulus money came in, NIH had the NIH challenge, 100 grant areas that they were going to support immediately with stimulus money. They were going to support 2 grants in each of the 100 areas. It turned out that 24,000 applications came in, and they eventually did 4 from each of the 100 areas. So they, out of 24,000 grant applications, they funded 400. Of the 100 categories, 98 were translational research categories and 2 were basic. It's that imbalance that I think is not appropriate. I think, as I mentioned before, I think it's very important to acknowledge that a lot of the discoveries don't come necessarily from this. I'm going to go back to the phrase about if you do translational research, you have to have something to translate. And so I'm personally somewhat dismayed by the fact that Columbia and Harvard and Hopkins and other medical schools are shifting from the traditional 2 years of preclinical medicine and 2 years of clinical medicine to now 1.5 years of preclinical medicine and 2.5 years of clinical. Although they say you can do some experiments in the last year. So they're actually not teaching people the basis on which they might be able to do some translational work. So I'm a little concerned about that. So I see this as going in the wrong direction. I think we should be training people in molecular biology and in genetics more than we do so that they could start applying some of these things. So the example that I really like about translational research happened about 45 years ago, and it happened in Iraq, and I only found out a couple years ago that it was my friend Kaisal Akwadi at Columbia who actually did it. And what he did is, he was a young doctor at the time, in the 1960s, so maybe it was even more than 45 years ago. And Iraq had a cholera epidemic. And as a young doctor, he was put in charge of the ward in the hospital where they brought all the cholera patients. Now, for those of you that don't know about cholera, cholera is a horrible disease. The cholera toxin released by the bacterium causes the intestine to basically work the wrong way around. Instead of absorbing salts and water, it causes chloride to come rushing into the lumen of the intestine. Potassium follows the chloride, so you have salt coming in, water follows it. And so people die because they lose 1 liter of liquid, quart of liquid, every hour. And so after about a day and a half, they dehydrate and they die. They don't have time for their immune systems to kick in and get rid of the bacteria. And Kais knew the standard medical procedure. The standard medical procedure was to take a patient and put them in a nice, clean, state-of-the-art hospital, stick a sterile IV into them, and give them salts and solution back in and replenish their fluids. And so he did this, and not a single person died when he was doing this. But he was thinking about this, that something like this was expensive. And in poor villages or poor countries, they couldn't afford to have sterile solutions and sterile equipment and all this care. Could there be something that he could do that would be better? And at the time, he knew about the basic research that had been done with trying to understand how our bodies absorb and take in sugars and amino acids. How do we actually get those into our body? And what was found, and what he knew about, is that there was something called sodium co-transport. that a sodium ion came in and it brought in a sugar molecule, or it brought in an amino acid. So he thought about this for a while and he said, I wonder if I give someone a solution that has salt and sugar in it and they drink that, because drinking water doesn't help with cholera, right? That just goes right through, the person doesn't come in. Maybe the sodium and chloride, sodium and the sugar will come in together, chloride will follow in, and then water will follow in, and they'll be able to take water, and we don't have to have sterile solutions. We don't have to have IVs. We just need to have a clean water supply and give these Gatorade, basically, right? And so that's what he did. He put that together and showed that it worked. That, to me, is fantastic translational medicine. Using the information. I'm sure that the people that worked on how we absorb nutrients had not thought about treating cholera. It took somebody really at that point of that knew the basic information and then applied it to a problem. So you have to have the information and you have to apply it. I'm not against translational medicine. I think it should be done. But I think we need to have, as in that example, a knowledge of how we absorb nutrients to be able to then use that in another way. We need to know more about the basic function of the human body and about animals in general that will give us ideas that we can take on in the future. I think I probably talked about that too much, so I should get another question if there is one. Yeah. You know, we know for some organisms, fireflies produce light as an attractant for mates. There are some crustaceans that also do this. They emit light. They have something somewhat like a corin, and they actually spit the molecule out in the water, and when it hits the calcium in the water, it has a little burst of light, and these crustaceans are really swimming along very fast, and so as they spit this stuff out, there's this little dashed line that follows them at dusk. And so so as a mate attractant, bioluminescence has also been documented to either attract prey or to startle predators to get them out of the way. But unfortunately, no one has any idea why the jellyfish produce light. So no one has come up with a good model of how that works. You may also ask the question, okay, so you don't know why it produces light. Why does it have to be green? It's already making a blue light. Why waste time? It turns out that if you go deep in the sea, the only light that actually travels any distance is blue light. And the jellyfish that are down there don't have GFP. So blue light's the only thing, because green light doesn't work there. I don't know why they have it at the surface, but they do. But there's one model why it is. It's a rather interesting model. Remember I said that GFP as a protein was a very efficient protein. For every 10 photons coming in, 9 photons came out. Well, that other molecule, a quorin, is horrible. For every chemical reaction that's done, for every 10 chemical reactions that are done, only one of them produces light. So you get a lot of heat that's produced, but it's a very inefficient process. It turns out, though, that it looks like it's the production of light that's the problem. That in a quorin, the first thing is to activate the molecule, and then the second part is to make the light. And so Shimomura actually found that if you take both the molecules and you stick them right together, and you activate one, and don't let it produce blue light, but because it's so close to GFP, it transfers its energy to the GFP molecule, which then makes green light. That overall process, remember, this was 10%, this was 90%. You know, if it was here and here, it would be even less. But because they're right together and they can transfer the energy, the overall reaction becomes 30%. So GFP may have evolved to allow for more efficient light production. At least that's one of the theories that's there. But why they produce light in the first place, haven't a clue.
Is there any mechanism or any example where they would have
There are some things that are in the infrared that are there are some molecules in the infrared, I think, that Roger has looked at. So, yes. I mean, if I had power?
If you had a blueprint that everybody wanted for how you can make this a higher frequency of your last line of science, what it really does, versus that first line about how the average power.
So one of the things that I found quite wonderful when I was a postdoc, I was in Sidney Brenner's lab. Sidney Brenner is an astonishing scientist. He still is at 87. And Sidney had, and the entire laboratory itself, the laboratory of molecular biology, was a fascinating place to work in. And because it had a couple of things associated with it. The first was people really loved science. They were just talking science all the time. I remember one time, so it's all molecular biologists, right? We're having coffee one morning, and somebody comes in and says, I've just heard that the astronomy department has the films of the Voyager 2 fly by Saturn or Jupiter. 35 molecular biologists got up, got in their cars, and drove to the astronomy department to watch the movie. I think that was pretty neat. It was a good movie. So that was one thing. The other thing is, there were wonderful colleagues, you know, just wonderful people to talk things over with. They had all the facilities we needed. I once went down to the stock room because I needed to do a chemical reaction where I needed to use ultraviolet light to convert a chemical. And so I went down and I said, I need a UV lamp. And the head of the stock room just looks at me and says, what wavelength? So. And that, and coupled with the other thing that I thought was really wonderful, is I was there for 5 years, and I worked with Sidney Brenner. I talked with Sidney once every year. He was my nominal advisor. I talked to lots of other people all the time, but he was doing his experiments, and he wanted us to be completely independent. And I found that really wonderful. It was also scary, because if you have all the facilities that you ever will need, all the supplies, you have great colleagues, and you're allowed to do anything you want. If it doesn't work, it's your fault. That's scary. That's really scary. And a lot of people floundered for a while, and then others. But most people really flourished in that. Sidney, right now at 87, is in Singapore. And Singapore has an interesting system where they pay for their citizens to go off and get PhDs, but then they have to come back and do their postdocs there. And so Sidney, finding that there were people coming back that were really well trained, but there wasn't really a good place for them, said, oh, I'll take them as my postdocs. And so he took a group of eight, and he said to them, here's the rules. Do anything you want. I just like to be excited about what you do. Didn't have to talk to him about it, didn't have to do anything. Just go do it. So I think, to me, that's still something in my memory I think is very important. I try to let the people in my life, I try not to get in their hair, which is, I think, the best thing. I pester them a lot, but I try not to be too overbearing. But I think letting people go and do their experiments and think about the things on their own and know that they're responsible for what they're doing, I think is very important. But I don't know if that, I didn't talk about the institute, the Chalfie Institute that I was going to make better. But that is certainly my ideal.